take the rain on the roof of this empty house. That don't bother me. I can take a few tears now and then and just let them out. I'm not afraid to cry every once in a while. Even though going on with you gone still upsets me. There are days every now and again I pretend I'm okay. But that's not what gets me. What hurts the most was being so close and having so much to say and watching you walk away and never knowing what could have been and not seeing that loving you is what I was trying to do.
What's wrong?
Future.
Smile when I see our old friends and I'm alone. Still harder getting up, getting dressed, living with this regret. But I know if I could do it over, I would trade, give away all the words that I saved in my heart.
Of the earth gets bigger, the trigger's cold, empty your pores.
What is your philosophy on life?
It sucks. Heavy metal rules. Heavy metal rules. All that punk sucks. It doesn't belong in this world. It belongs on Mars, man. Seriously. Heavy metal definitely rules. Ozzy, Priest, Scorpions, American Hi-Fi, Dokken. It all rules.
Her nails and she don't know he's got her best friend on the phone. She'll wash her hair, his dirty clothes are all he gives to her, and he's got posters on the walls of all the girls he wished she was, and he means everything to her. Her boyfriend, he don't know Stone Nintendo. I wish that I could make her see. She's just the flavor of the week. It's Friday night and she's all alone. He's a million miles away. She's dressed to kill, but the TV's on. Pictures on the wall of all the girls he's loved before, and she knows all his favorite songs. Her boyfriend, he don't know anything about her. He's too stoned. Nintendo, I wish that I could make her see.
This is not fucking possible. This cannot be true! What is that there? What is that there? What is that? Look! Look! What the fuck is this? I'm asking a question! I'm asking a question, what is it?
What is going on, everyone? Let me clear my throat. I tried to get the hollering out of the way last night for 3 hours. And before the show started, I can't even talk. Can't even talk tonight. See C-Dog in the back room there. Appreciate you guys showing up. I'll go up here through the chat. John Burns in the house says, we have a shakeup on the defensive coaching staff. That's right. If you've been living under a bridge and I haven't heard, Andrew Thacker has been demoted to safeties coach. So I don't know what that says about Tillman. And Kevin Sherrer, co-DC, has been promoted to defensive coordinator. We'll be talking about that tonight. I4U 1126, a risky move, but I think it is for the best. Probably. CJ with a bunch of googly eyes. FaceZack says, yo, what's up, Wreck? What's going on, man? I mean, I think I know. I think I'm in the depression stage right now. We talked about this last night. I forget who asked what. Is it the stages of grief that I'm in? I was in anger for a while. I think I'm in depression. I did not want to get up this morning. David Knorr, I don't. He is a good. I don't know if he's a good coach either. He hasn't done much with the linebackers. It's a good point. T Branch, member of the channel, says rolling on the floor laughing. Yeah, I did have some memes queued up and ready to go. Adam Burgess, these memes, LMAO, LMAO. Todd says BB King song, Thrill Is Gone. David, how many missed tackles did Tech have Saturday? At one point, it was almost laughable. It was laughable for the entire game. We made number four for Bowling Green look like Marshawn Lynch. I thought I was going to hear in a press game conference in Bowling Green, thanks for asking. I'm just here so I don't get fined. I thought that was what we were going to get. But it wasn't Marshawn Lynch. Looked like it. T-Branch, hell of a show. J&D Truck says, wow, a demotion. At least he's still employed. He's done, though. When you're in a leadership role like that and you get demoted, first of all, you rarely get demoted. There's a reason for that. But his days at Tech are numbered. Slim says, glad to be able to have a primetime scrimmage next week. I hope that your whole team feels that way. And if you want to know how to do that as a team, watch what Tech did at practice last week. Scrolling down. Jeff Collins is in the house. That piece of garbage. Nothing wrong with being a pool boy for my sweet Kirby. Yeah, Jeff Collins did spend the night with Kirby last night, I'm fairly certain. It's pretty disgusting. Mystic Gaming, glad to see we're on the same page. Absolutely. BC Georgia Tech Jackets in the house. What's going on? BC, another Georgia Tech content creator. Bulldog Brian says, Bowling Green, LMAO. Nothing I can say. Yeah, it is incredibly embarrassing. Backwards hat check, sunglasses check, spit cup check. Yeah, it's going to be a long night. Your pet cat meow. We are not dead, not even close. My proof, George O'Leary, the dude, was the DC for Bill Lewis, who coincidentally was the last coach canned midseason. His first year at 95 went 6-5, 10-2 in 98. I hope so, man. Thank you for injecting some life into – or some positivity where there's little to be found. Millis Vanillas, howdy everyone, RTR. What's going on, Millis? B Bean, is this rap music? No, that was Flavor of the Week. And I think I've got everyone. New King God, I'm glad y'all made the change is give Mario a reason to have. Would y'all type where I can't read that good, no ways. Help me out a little bit. What's up, WreckTalk, says Eliza Jenkins. All right, it's time to bring the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Sea Dog. What's going on, buddy?
Hey.
I feel the same way. So, big news right now. Andrew Thacker demoted to safeties coach. Like I said, I don't know what that means for Travaris Tillman. What do you think about this move?
I've actually got a video uploading now on it. I don't know. I was not one of the ones that was calling for Thacker's head, even really after last night. I don't know. I'm just really slow to kind of. I don't have the knee-jerk reaction that a lot of people have. You know what I mean? A lot of people wanted Thacker fired before, you know, last night or whatever. And I thought, you know, I'm just really slow to want to do that because, well, first of all, we've seen his defenses be good, last year, you know, and then I kind of thought it was just a personnel thing. Like, I thought we were just having trouble replacing the production and leadership of guys like Ace and Charlie. But which Paul Morales said as much. I mean, he said that, you know, he's failed to be a leader on the team, and that's evident. So I'm just kind of the opinion that, I don't know, I'm just really slow to kind of jump to conclusions about that kind of thing. But after a loss like this, I mean, it's not, I mean, something's got to change, like, majorly, you know? So could this be some kind of, like, show? I don't know. First of all, I thought that they were co-defensive coordinators already, or was I mistaken?
Well, that might be the case. Yeah, I'm not sure. To me, it seemed evident. I mean, obviously, if we're making this move, I think that Thacker had the reins of the defense.
Right.
But Kevin Sherrer was co-defensive coordinator. And I'm with you. I'm never that quick to say fire everybody. Anyone who's watched me for any length of time knows that. But if Key – because here's the thing. I put out a tweet today that I'm like, Key is not on the longest leash himself. Yeah. And he's got to get something going. And as bad as the defense has been, and if Key makes this move, then, yeah, I think it's the right move, and it's the move that needed to be made. The thing that makes you kind of like, I don't know, though, is that our linebackers have not looked good at all. And that was the position group that Kevin Sherrer coached now.
Yeah. I just kind of tend to – think it's a personnel thing. I don't think we have as good players there as last year. You know, it's really hard to replace guys like Charlie and Ace and the leadership and seniority that they had, especially with transfers. So,
yeah,
I don't know. I just tend to lean more towards that. You know, I'm a slow to react kind of guy. I like to see what a coach can do after a few years of recruiting. Cause I mean, you know, you got to put it in perspective. Like, this is his first year, too. So I know that we're expecting more continuity and everything. And I'm sorry. I'm so sad. Just, like, bear with me. I know we were all expecting more continuity and everything, but I mean, there's no shortcuts, I guess. You know, this is still a program that needs to be rebuilt. And I'm not even sure that I agree with the move. I mean, if Key thinks that's the best, then okay. Maybe he doesn't think that he can get him fired up enough to, you know, to perform better. But I really don't know that if we weren't able to get this going on defense, like if we weren't able to get the maximum effort out of them before, I don't know what doing this is going to do. It might be an overcorrection. I didn't even say that in my video. It was like a instant reaction kind of thing because I had just seen it and I hadn't really thought about it much. But, you know, now that I'm kind of talking through it, I mean, it's like, I don't know. Seems kind of knee-jerk to me. I mean, a lot of people might heavily disagree, but I've seen proof of concept with Thacker. You know, I've seen what they can do. But so I'm kind of the opinion that you give them a year or two to recruit. You know, the recruiting class and transfer class this past year wasn't great. But listen, there's no excuse for losing to Bowling Green, getting blown out by them. This is going to kill recruiting. This is going to kill, any transfers that potentially think about coming here. Like, this is going to kill that. You have to be able to – you have to win this game, dude. You have to. I mean, you struggle, that's fine. You know, you look back on it, you know, you can no-show a game and still win it. You don't lose, and you certainly don't get dominated and blown out. It's ridiculous, man. It's totally, completely unacceptable. And it's gonna really, really do a lot of damage. And it's so depressing to see this in such an important year for Georgia Tech, and you know, you finally get the slightest amount of hope, and the repercussions of this are more so than just losing this game, I think.
Yeah, I think you're most likely right.
This is devastating.
Yeah, because we had recruits there too, and that was awful. You know, Mystic Gaming with the $10 super chat says, don't take this the wrong way, but the team doesn't know how to win. It's tough to get the stink of losing off. It took a few seasons after Bill Lewis for O'Leary to get them right. Yeah, I mean, we kind of talked about this last night, C-Dog, with just kind of shaking this mentality and playing tight and kind of – it's one of the things Key talked about when he first took over as interim was, like, kind of waiting for something bad to happen. We didn't just wait for something bad to happen yesterday. Bad things happen. And I agree with you, too, that I don't know what this – I think the Thacker decision is going to make a lot of fans happy. As far as what it's going to do on the field, I don't really know. I stand behind what I said last night. I don't think this is just a remove Thacker and everything is hunky-dory on defense, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Like, you have to think about who's replacing it. Now, Kevin Sherrer's been in the business for a long time, and he's got all these years of experience, and I'm sure that he could do a good job, but, like, it's not necessarily – yesterday was 100% a mental effort kind of thing. It wasn't, like, any kind of scheme or anything, or was it talent, you know? It was effort. It was, you know, just no-showing and not being prepared.
Yep.
That's what it was. It was the players not putting in enough effort. And that is what – that's what you got to get fixed. So that's what I'm looking at. Is Kevin Sherrer going to be able to get more effort out of him? I don't know.
Yeah. And the thing is, like, it wasn't like just the defense played bad yesterday. Like, the whole team played equally bad, in my opinion.
The offense, gets shut out second, third quarter.
Kevin Sherrer doesn't coach the offense, right? Like this, like I said last night, this seems like a systemic team issue.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Seems like just a Band-Aid or something to kind of look good and get, because now we're not talking about the loss. We're talking about this defensive coordinator change. You know, we haven't even had time to talk about how horrible of a loss this is. Now we're talking about the defensive coordinator situation. Why don't we talk about, the recruits there, or the fans that are never going to go do another Tech game again, or the players now that their entire season is derailed, or because everything we wanted to do is still in front of us, you know? Bowling, 8 wins. That's what the team said all offseason. 8 wins. They want to get 8 wins. Well, not happening.
No, and
bowl game is the absolute height of what this team's capable of.
100%. Fazak with the $2 super check says, "Good thing is Key is making moves. This is bright." I mean, we'll see. I do agree with C-Dog. This could absolutely backfire as well. Now we have Benjamin London in the house with Go Jackets, and I would really love to hear. Do you have some sense behind the scenes what led to this decision? Talking about the game yesterday, or what are you hearing?
Yeah, I think it's basically what every fan is hearing right now is, you know, addressed in that email that got sent to a lot of us in the media, that Thacker and their defense obviously wasn't doing enough that lived up to the Georgia Tech standards. And obviously something had to go and something had to make a change. Coach Sherrer has obviously had a ton of coaching experiences with the I want to say it's the Giants before coming over to Georgia Tech to be the linebackers coach and co-defensive coordinator. And so they decided to elevate him while also retaining Andrew Thacker, but moving him to safeties coach. So, you know, it's an interesting move to kind of keep a guy, especially after you demote him. But, you know, it is intriguing to see what Coach Sherrer can do, because he has a very good relationship with a lot of Georgia high school head coaches because he was one himself. So this is an intriguing move, and it could be just a recruiting move to kind of say, hey, you know, this gives us opportunities for more connections to say, hey, we have a defensive coordinator that, you know, coached in the state of Georgia in high school football. So it's an intriguing move for sure, especially I think one person said it best, with the linebackers playing the way they are. You know, it's probably not one of their favorite moves that they made, but Georgia Tech just having to do something different in order to shake things up for sure.
Yeah, now what happens to Travaris Tillman? Because he's the current defensive backs coach. Like, have we heard anything about, like, is he out or is he moving to an administrative role or what?
So there's nothing on him, and I think he'll stay the defensive backs coach. I think that's why they emphasize safety coach for Andrew Thacker. So Tillman will probably just maintain the corners, and then Andrew Thacker will really just focus specifically on the safeties, but no word on Coach Tillman.
Yeah, just to let you know, I mean, you can trash Georgia Tech all you want in the chat, that's fine, but if you just spam the same thing 80 times, that'll get you banned, so just letting you know.
Or we just ignore it. We just keep tracking.
Now we all know. So them's are the rules. Were you at the game yesterday?
I was not. I was actually up in North Greenville, but I did get the chance to watch a lot of. Yeah, that's why I put in my Twitter, you know, the post I made. I said, thankful to be up here behind the microphone. And it was some people took that the wrong way. And they were like, oh, you didn't want to be at Georgia Tech watching that bloodbath. And I'm like, no, that's not the shot I took at Georgia Tech. But now I did get to go back and watch all the game, and just a lot of things I realized. One was just tackling. It has been a consistent issue from week one all the way to now. And, you know, I think when I was watching the player interviews, I was kind of upset with Paul Malala saying that they overlooked a team like Bowling Green. I mean, if you're a championship-level team, you can't overlook anybody. It doesn't matter what their record is. It doesn't matter what conference they're in. And so it's a tough blow for Georgia Tech for sure.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it last night. We did like a 3.5-hour show of like, this has to be the most devastating loss that I've ever experienced as a Tech fan, just because we expected a lot more. We kind of thought we were beyond, I don't know if I want to say overlooking a team. Like, I can overlook a team. I don't play on the field, but that we wouldn't be prepared to play a team like Bowling Green that is not a good Group of Five team at all. And that we couldn't at any point in the game get anything going was, I don't really know what to think. I guess that's what you accredit this, move to from DC, to Kevin Sherrer. But, it's devastating for sure. And now there's really not a game on our schedule that I think that, well, we should win that one, you know?
Yeah. And that was the big thing I think a lot of people realized too, was like, hey, Bowling Green was one of those games going into the year where you're like, yeah, Georgia Tech's going to win that one, like circle it off as a win. And, you know, you come out flat. And I think one of the things I took away, and I've told this to a lot of people specifically today, you know, every team's going to have that one bad game. And, you know, sometimes you are able to come out with a win, but it's just by a few points, just like Georgia did against Auburn. It wasn't pretty, but they were able to get the win. But for Georgia Tech, unfortunately, you know, their bad game comes against Bowling Green, and it makes it look completely worse. So, you know, Haynes King didn't really look his best, just a couple of bad reads. Underthrowing a guy when a veteran quarterback would know, hey, if it's one-on-one and you got your guy deep down the field, throw it over his head. If that, don't throw it too short. You know, just some of the wide receiver play was off a little bit. Dominic Blaylock played a heck of a game from his part. So he did his job. You know, the run game wasn't really there. The offensive line without Jordan Williams looks very sad and very depressing. So, there's a lot of questions, but then really in the whole entire defense, not a lot of pressure that you saw in the Wake Forest game. Georgia Tech's defense didn't really show a ton of stunts, a ton of blitz. They couldn't stop the run. They couldn't stop the pass game. And it was just very concerning defensively more than it was offensively to me. And I think that's why they made the change this afternoon.
Yeah.
You know what you're saying about having a bad game is like, you know, I thought what gets me is that we don't learn. Like, you could say that we had a bad game against Louisville when we were up 28-13 at halftime and let them come back on us. And you say, oh, well, don't get comfortable, you know. Don't get comfortable. No lead is big enough. You think they'd learn by now. And then, you know, it happens again against Wake Forest. We almost let them come back and win. That game was way too close for comfort. We wound up winning. But it's like, did they forget? Did they not learn from their mistakes? Like, can we not take what we've learned? Or are they just forgetting about that? And, you know, yeah. I don't know where this overconfidence comes from, where we can think we can just roll into and beat any team and, you know, sit on a lead and think the other team's just going to lay down and die because that's what we did for years, you know?
Yeah, I think that's a good point. Like, there's been several circumstances during this season. Louisville, even against South Carolina State, we didn't look that great. Against Ole Miss, it was what it was. And then against Wake, we have 5 turnovers and the game's still close when it shouldn't be. There's all these examples that, hey, there's no reason to think you can overlook anyone, and we do. Sorry, go ahead, Ben.
Yeah, and, I mean, to your point, I mean, Louisville, we walked into the, you know, post-game presser, and I think it would have been Jalen King probably was the one that said, hey, like, we just went into the locker room thinking we had this game in the bag. That was probably one of the first indications where I was like, you know, that's the turning point. Veteran guy says, hey, we need to correct those things. Jalen King's been in the program long enough. He's a veteran guy, able to use his voice and be a leader on this defense to say something like that and then go out and prove it the next week. Here they come against South Carolina State. Really had some good flashes at times on offense, but struggled a little bit on defense here and there, especially in that third and fourth quarter. And then Wake Forest, you obviously see, you know, you go up big, pretty big in that first half, and then you degress everything that happens in that second half. Just like C-Dog mentioned, you know, they kind of come crawling back, and then you have that momentum where you're like, hey, you won that game, first ACC win. You know, you want to be able to get that one win to get over 500, and jeez, unfortunately, you just stall throughout the whole game. And it's like what Brent Key said. And I hate the analogy that people are throwing out there that this Brent Key's exactly like Jeff Collins, because he's definitely not. I mean, Jeff Collins would go out there and make a bunch of excuses. And I mean, I don't know Jeff Collins personally, but like he would just go out there and make excuses and say, it almost kind of like he was pointing fingers at individual coaches or individual players without saying their names. Brent Key, I love the one thing that he did say is it starts with me as the head coach because I'm in control of everybody. He took full responsibility. And he said, hey, we're going to have to do some things differently. And he made an action today to prove, hey, we are going to do some things differently. So that may be the step in the right direction that they want. But now you're going to go into a tougher opponent this week in Miami who has a ton of momentum going their way. They're undefeated in ACC play. ACC play. They knocked off a Texas A&M squad that who knows if they're good or not. They played a couple non-conference opponents that really aren't that strong. And Georgia Tech, we've mentioned this 100 times, probably has one of the tougher schedules in the ACC. And so that may play dividends when they get to this Miami game. But how much momentum can you bring now without a win? And how do you get your guys back on track this week and get them focused and dialed in to be ready to fix those mistakes starting tomorrow? And I bet you they've already started fixing those mistakes today as well by watching that film and saying, hey, defense, you got to tackle better. I mean, the first tackle, yards after contact, was absolutely insane, and you can't have numbers like that going forward.
Yeah. I mentioned that yesterday. We have now an almost impossible task ahead of us because you say, well, when you have a horrible loss like this, you know, and it's kind of still – I mean, not quite halfway through the season, you know, we still got a lot of football left. How do you respond to this? You know what I mean?
Because now we're at a crossroads where do we let this game beat us a bunch more times, or do we go the way and you know, make an improvement and say this will never happen again and change our mindset and change the way we do things and learn from it, and you know, and now, and so you say, okay, well, you got to look at how we do this next week. Well, we're most likely losing to Miami. Okay. It would be a monumental upset if we actually managed to beat Miami. So can we do this and, you know, put up a fight or something against them? And can we feel good about ourselves, even a loss? I mean, obviously no moral victories and all that, but it's like, can you instill that new mindset and try to change things while still losing this next week? Is what I'm saying. We're most likely going to lose. Can you still do that? And it's going to be near impossible. It's going to be near impossible.
Well, I'll say this, and I think every football coach in the whole entire universe will tell you this. Every week you want to go 1-0. You don't want to focus on what you did last week. You obviously do want to focus on the things you did wrong and try to correct those things and make sure – you do the right things to make sure that never happens again, like you mentioned. And so obviously they're going to probably work a lot with the defense and say, hey, you know, in this run game, defensive lineman, you got to make that first initial tackle. It shouldn't get to that third level like it did multiple times in that Bowling Green game. It should never happen, especially that many times. And so, you know, some of those guys were just playing off games. You know, you have an off game here or there from some individual guys, but how do you work to fix those things? And I think the turning point is just saying, hey, can you take some positives out against the Miami game to kind of give you that momentum where you feel like, hey, this was a really strong part. I mean, when we walked out of the Wake Forest game, we said, man, that defensive line, that's our strong point that we can look forward to for the rest of the year and kind of have that momentum going forward. And then, you know, they take a step back. So how do you get that momentum to take that step back forward this week against Miami? Well, you can do that same thing on defense where you're pressuring the quarterback on a couple of stunts, a couple of different formations lined up, get those linebackers more involved, and then when you have those DBs and safeties, you know, out there in coverage or in man-to-man, you know, go and win those 50-50 balls that get thrown up. Go and be able to bat the ball down before it gets to the receiver. And then on the offensive side, you know, you just want to see some more – of the offensive line gel together better than what they have, because obviously the run game really didn't get going. Jamal Haynes really didn't have that big of a game. That was probably one of his first quiet moments that he's had all season, where he's not been that electrifying running back that we've seen up to this point. I mean, you know, you saw different guys that they were rotating in just to try to get something going, like Trey Cooley, Dante Smith. They were rotating guys in and out to try to get something going on offense, and they just weren't able to do so in the run game. And that's the same thing with the receiving corps. Eric Singleton, I mean, he did his job too. Give him credit. I mean, he did his job as well. Dominic Blaylock did a fantastic job as well. But those other receivers have got to get involved. I know Malik Rutherford scored his first touchdown of the year. It didn't even feel like, you know, it felt like he should have had 4 or 5 touchdowns the way, you know, we talked about him in the preseason. So, you know, just things on offense got to get rolling a little bit, get more guys involved. And not make things too simple. And I think that's what we did towards the end of that game, is we got too simple and we were trying to come up with some of those simple play calls to get those 4 or 5 yards, and it just wasn't working on the Bowling Green defense. And give them credit. I mean, they came out, they came prepared, and they smashed Georgia Tech right in the mouth, and that's exactly what they plan to do. And Georgia Tech, and I think it's just intriguing to me to still think, you know, some of the guys, and I think it was Lamile Brooks who was shocked to hear that Paul Malala was even saying, hey, you know, we did overlook them, because Miles Brooks was like, no, we didn't overlook them. Maybe some other guys did, but definitely not the whole team. And so even when one or two guys overlook an opponent, it's going to affect your whole team, because now you're going to go out there saying, hey, here's a guy playing 100%, and then here's a guy playing maybe 50, 75. And so that's something I think they'll fix going forward as well. And that starts with Brent Key.
Yeah, a few things for me. Number one, face Zach again, with the $5 super chat says, we knocked off two ranked teams last year with a worse offense and a better defense. Mm-hmm. If Sherrer helps at all, we have a chance, a small chance. And I'll agree with that. Now, for the people that are saying Collins and Key are the same coach, I don't get that.
That ticks me off.
I can tell you what Collins would have said in that press conference if he was coaching that game. He said, look, now that's a great team out there. They've got a great quarterback. That running back is I'm going to recruit him later. He's fantastic, okay? And the first thing we got to do is love these kids, all right? I think that we were just a few plays away, all right? We're going to get those things fixed. Now, you said with Brent Key taking responsibility, and I said this last night, yeah, absolutely. Really, that's the only thing I think you can do as a head coach in that situation is take the responsibility. But here's the thing, and it's just like any job any of us work. If you say, yep, my bad, I totally effed that up, but you're having that conversation with your boss every week, that's no good. So you got to actually fix these things. As far as playing Miami, I'm not saying we got to go out there and beat Miami. And it's not even a score thing because people are like, oh, well, if we play them within this many points. No, it has nothing to do with that. Mm-hmm. Fundamentals. Can you tackle? You know, can you get a little bit of pressure? Can you run your offense somewhat effectively? Can the guys that you expect to play well, like Haynes King and Jamal Haynes? That's what I'm looking for. Now, if we come out next week and it looks the same, then I don't know what to say. I mean, I kind of feel like it can't be any worse than what we saw yesterday, though. I do know.
We could come out, and if we just get blown off the field, then that will be an indicator. You know, that'll be reminiscent of Jeff Collins. If we just absolutely get blown off the field, that'll kind of tell us what we're in store for the rest of the season, because the team absolutely could just cash it in at this point.
Yeah, and we kind of talked about that last night with, I mean, it's a choice you have to make as a team, as a staff. Like, are you going to just roll over and say, look, this season's a loss. No one really cares. We're just going to kind of phone this thing in. And it's interesting you said that Lamiles Brooks, I don't know where you saw that from, but he was saying that, I don't know where Paul Mola got that from. We weren't overlooking anyone. And I don't know what's going on with Paul Mola, and I don't really mean to call the guy out directly, but he gives press conferences.
I mean, he said it, so.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to take shots at him either. Like, you know, he just came out and said, you know, I think. And I don't know if he was speaking about just himself and a couple other guys in the locker room, or if he was talking about the overall general and the feel that he got from his team. And then Lamiles Brooks, when he was asked about it, I mean, immediately after, it was with him and Haynes King. He didn't directly say, you know, I didn't know, hey, like, I didn't know he said that. Oh, my gosh, I'm shocked. I don't believe that. He was just like, no, I don't think that was the overall thought of the team. And, you know, he said, yeah, you know, maybe one or two guys thought that maybe, but that's not the overall team aspect going into this game. So, you know, there may have been, it's like I said, maybe one or two guys on this team thought, hey, it's just Bowling Green. They're in the MAC conference, you know. It's no big deal. But here they are again, and in a similar situation to NIU a couple years ago, where you lose a game that you circled as a win to begin the year. So it's tough to look at it right now. But if Georgia Tech can kind of turn this thing around against Miami and build some of that momentum, and I'm not saying you have to go out and win against Miami, because if you get that momentum going out of Miami, you get into an off week, and that's enough time for guys like Chase Lane to get healthy again, Jordan Williams to get healthy again. These guys who have been injured for quite some time and haven't seen a lot of snaps and a lot of reps, they get healthy. You have that momentum going into the off week. You can correct a lot of those things that you've struggled with in the first half of the season during that first off week, and then it gives you momentum to go forward throughout the rest of the year and be able to make, you know, some potential strides and runs on some good teams later on down the road.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think all is lost either, but it's an uphill battle. Go ahead, C-Dog.
I don't know. I was going to say, I haven't seen the press conferences yet. I'm wondering, though, if we didn't overlook Bowling Green, then what happened? Did he say that?
Yeah, that would. What was the follow-up question to that? Because that's what it should have been. If it wasn't you overlooked him, what do you attribute the play to?
Yeah, are they just better? Are they much better than us? That can't be.
I don't think there was a follow-up question to it. I think he just responded by saying, you know, that's something that we shouldn't have done. Obviously, you know, defensive-wise, speaking as a linebacker, you know, they just weren't executing the tackles. They weren't executing those play, those simple wrap-up plays where they bounced off their linebackers, defensive linemen, and even safeties and corners at this point in the third level. And they were just bouncing off and getting extra yards. And it's just those fundamental things that we've talked about earlier where it's just like, hey, we got to correct on some of those fundamentals and get those things corrected. And, you know, this point in the season, you don't want to be going back to those fundamental things. But if you're Georgia Tech, you're going to have to. And it's not just Georgia Tech that's struggling with this. I've seen it throughout college football all year long. At every single level of college football, Division I, Division II, Division III. NAIA. I mean, it's at all levels where everybody's just struggling to tackle. And it's just insane. Like, it makes no sense that, you know, teams who, you know, are at the top of the level. I mean, that LSU Florida State game at the beginning of the year, I could count on, you know, both hands and both toes how many missed tackles I saw from, you know, both teams. So it's not just, you know, Georgia Tech that's struggling with this. It's college football in general. But Georgia Tech, obviously, it gets focused on them more because of the loss to Bowling Green. And that's why it's a big point of emphasis. Like, there were some in the Wake Forest game. There were some in the South Carolina State game. But you won those games. So you're not going to bring it up. You're not going to mention it. You may mention it here and there if it's obviously observant. And you're like, hey, like they got this massive play downfield where they scored a touchdown because of a bunch of missed tackles. There's a bunch of big plays that happened for Bowling Green because of all those missed tackles. And so that's what they're going to have to do. And Paul mentioned it. He was like, we just got to correct those things in order to get back on track. And that, I agree with that. I think that's something that they'll have to do going forward.
I want to know also why we can't make adjustments in game. You know, it's like whatever we go into the game with is what we got. And, you know, the other, it's like, this has been kind of a recurring thing, I think, even last year under Brent Key. It's like the other team will adjust, and we got to hope that, you know, whatever we've been doing in the first half is going to work in the second half because, you know, we came out at halftime. And I think Brent Key said you can let the first half beat you, or you can do something about it. And clearly that didn't happen. So, you know, why can't we? What is going on at halftime to where we can't make adjustments? Because that's the issue. You know, it happened against Louisville, it happened against Wake, happened against, like, even going back to last year, like Duke. We beat them, but, you know, we let them come back, and it's just. I don't know, man. It's like,
yeah. And you mentioned, you know, the adjustments that are being made at halftime. Somebody did ask, it's like, you know, obviously in that third and fourth quarter, teams are just rolling over you guys offensively.
Yeah.
And his response was, well, we only had two good drives, and that was it. So we didn't play good in the second quarter. We didn't play good in the third quarter and played good in the fourth quarter. He's like, so it's not just the third and fourth quarter that we're focusing on. You know, it's the whole game overall. I mean, after those first two drives that Georgia Tech had, if you're a fan, you're sitting there like, oh, this is going to be an easy blow-through win. And you're sitting there comfortable in your seat. You can be drinking a beer, and you're like, man, this is going to be a great game right here. But then all of a sudden, you know, Bowling Green goes down on that long drive, and then they, you know, they feel like they're in it. And then they go down and score another, get the field goal. I mean, that they're rolling through Georgia Tech at this point and getting defensive stops on defense. And so they had all that momentum going into the half. And Brent Key said, you know, I told everybody as soon as we walked in the locker room, it's only a 3-point game. Like, you guys got to choose to either step up or lie down, and it's up to you guys. And he said, we're going to make the adjustments. And obviously, you know, coming out in that third quarter, those adjustments, I guess some of the things that they saw in that first half changed completely in the second half. And it's just as, you know, I think I was listening to the radio broadcast with Andy Demetra and Joe Hamilton. I think one of the things that they saw was, man, they were running triple option, they were running counter, they were running smash, they were running all different kinds of running options But then they were also doing it so much differently in the pass game. And there's just so much you can do to dial in and say, all right, this is what's going to happen on this play offensively when they're running about three or four different types of offenses that, you know, Georgia Tech may not saw on film the week prior. So that may have been something that I think, you know, if they came out and said, you know, hey, they did some things we didn't even see in film this week. Like, if that was one of the things that was said, I would have felt a little bit more comfortable because I was like, hey, like, you know, they did run a couple different things here and there, but no one ever mentioned that other than the radio broadcast. So, you know, it's intriguing for me to kind of see, you know, that second half adjustment. And then I think the other thing that I thought was important that Joe Hamilton said was, hey, what's that, like, who's that veteran leader that's going to go out and play mad and play upset that you're down, you know, 38-14? Like, who's going to be that guy? And there was no one on the sideline that he could point out and saying, hey, he's not going to get in a fight with his own teammate, but he's going to go up there and hype his guys up and say, hey, we need to get this fixed. We need to get it fixed now. Let's go out and score on this drive. He goes up to a coach and says, hey, give me the ball. On defense, yeah. Hey, let me go after the quarterback. Like, who's that guy? And there was no one from Georgia Tech that did that this weekend. And I think that's another big thing that they're going to have to look at this week and just say, hey, who's our leader on our offense? And then who's that leader on that defense that wants the ball at all times? And that's something that they're going to have to look for this week.
Yeah, there's got to be a culture and mindset change too. Is something that I think that we've overlooked. Because I think just as many of the on-field problems are mental as they are, not like I keep saying as the personnel. I think a lot of the issues we have are in our heads too, and that's something that we saw a lot under Jeff Collins, and that's going to have to be weeded out probably over the course of maybe a couple of years.
And I said, you know, somebody mentioned something similar to that. And we do all have to go think back. And I did say this today on Twitter or on X, whatever you want to call it. You know, one of the things that you got to think is this is Brent Key's first full year as a head coach. I mean, he didn't know he was going to be a head coach last year. I don't think anybody knew that. I think he obviously knew, hey, I had a shot at being the head coach, but I'm not Georgia Tech's first option at being the head coach. And so he was fighting for his job, and he kind of knew that. And so, you know, now with him being a head coach, there's a lot of things he'll have to learn. And just similar to what Jeff Collins learned, you know, you're going to have to go out and say, hey, this fan base will not tolerate it for long. There's not a short – you're on a very, very short leash with this fan base, obviously, with, you know, attendance being as low as it is, not a lot of fan support within the stadium. As I mean, it was raining down boos in the second quarter. I mean, that automatically tells you, hey, you're on a short leash. And so I think, you know, he knows and understands, hey, changes have to be made. And I think that's why he made the change today. It's because he knows, hey, if I don't make a change, you know, it's my job on the line. It's not everybody else's. It's my job. And so I think, you know, he understands the situation that they're in at Georgia Tech, and he understands, hey, this may take a little bit longer than what people expect. And I think a lot of people had some high expectations for this Georgia Tech team going into the year. And I think Brent Key had I did too. 7-5 was my prediction. But, you know, obviously I don't think they're going to surpass that. They'll be lucky to get 6-6, but I think 5-7 is realistic. And I know that Brent Key will come out and say, we're not pleased with what happened. And I think everybody will say, hey, we're not pleased with what happened. But it's how you respond next year. But you got to keep fighting this year and not just throw in the towel. And that's something easy that I think that we saw a lot in Jeff Collins' days where, I mean, that loss to NIU. I could automatically see everybody throwing in that towel after that game. Like, no one wanted to go out and compete. No one wanted to go out and win. And that's hopefully something I don't want to see going forward against a team like Miami and teams like North Carolina and Clemson, who, you know, Clemson's been struggling early in the year. And, you know, you can have that potential upset later on in the year, but you got to go out and compete and try to attempt to win games against teams like Miami and North Carolina first.
Yeah, I mean, a few things. One, a guy said you need your own radio show, Ben. Has Andy Demetra reached out to you?
No, he has not, but I've met Andy a couple times. Andy is, you know, I do some broadcasting stuff on the side. And Andy's been a huge help in that, and so is Wiley Ballard. So shout out Wiley Ballard. I mean, he's really helped me do a lot of different things. So really good friend of mine as well.
Awesome. And as far as like the teams doing different things than what they showed on film, I heard that. First of all, I would be kind of prone to get behind that if we hadn't had the body of work we've had. I heard that against South Carolina State too. That's why they were able to gash us on the run. They hadn't really run the option stuff. And it doesn't explain the tackling. When you meet a guy at the line of scrimmage or in the backfield and he breaks off a 15-yard run, that has nothing to do with what film
you saw on film.
Yeah, so that's got to get corrected. And maybe that's something we should talk about too, just the general fan base at Georgia Tech. I think the thing is, every coach in Division I college athletics, and particularly Power 5 programs, are on a shorter lease than they've ever been on in the history of college football. The thing is, Georgia Tech probably has the longest leash of any of those Division I or Power 5 programs. I cannot think of a program in this country that Jeff Collins would have survived as long as he did. He would have been
Iowa.
Maybe Iowa.
Iowa, man.
Maybe Nebraska.
Northwestern.
Yeah.
Virginia Tech.
Yeah, there's not the point being there's not many. Yeah. But I do think you're right. Key does know he's coaching for his job, and he doesn't have any favors of what we've all experienced Jeff Collins. So we're all in a freaking bad mood the minute that he takes over, right? And anytime we see things like this, I mean, that is kind of the natural inclination of like, here we go again. Here we go again with this complete nonsense. And we need something. That's what I'm looking for this week against Miami. Yeah. It's like you said you like the Matrix meme, Sea Dog. He's beginning to believe. That's what I need to begin to believe again. All right, so show me something. I mean, damn it, show me something against Miami where I can believe in this team. You know, someone in the chat talked about toughness, and I agree. Where is that toughness we've been hearing about? Because I hadn't seen it in a minute. Right, I didn't see any of it yesterday, and that don't have nothing to do with skill or ability or any of that. That has to do with what kind of player do you want to be, and so that's what I'm looking for. Sorry, I got.
And it's not just like toughness; it's mental toughness. Like, hey, when you get down, how do you respond to adversity? And that's something Georgia Tech has not shown greatly of this year, because obviously you get down in Louisville, you don't come back, and you don't win that football game. You know, you get down against, you know, Wake Forest starts to come back, and offensively you can't do anything anymore. You know, and it's and obviously against Bowling Green, you get down and you don't respond. And if you do, it's, you know, a late touchdown or late in the football game to where it already felt like the game was already over. And so, you know, how do you respond to adversity in the right time and have that mental toughness to say, hey, you know, it could be 38-0, but hey, it's still at the third quarter for crying out loud. Let's go out and score, you know, on every single offensive drive we have for the rest of the game. Let's dial up what Buster Faulkner thinks has worked early in that first half on those first two drives. Let's dial that up again. Let's try to, you know, throw a bomb for 53 yards to Eric Singleton and allow him to go make those one-on-one plays with him and the cornerback in the secondary. You know, dial up something like that. And that's something that you didn't see late in that game, is they weren't willing to take shots downfield. They weren't willing to go up and trust those wide receivers like Dominic Blaylock, who had a massive game. You know, that's the concern that I had. And I'm not blaming it specifically on Buster Faulkner. I'm just blaming it overall on the offense and, you know, the defense and really the whole coaching staff. I mean, there's no adjustments that were made. Sea Dog mentioned, and it's just concerning going forward. And so when you get down, how do you respond? And it comes with those in-game adjustments. And, you know, Georgia Tech hasn't really made a lot of them this year. And that's really concerning going forward into this Miami game. And hopefully the defensive coaching change allows that to happen a little bit, and we start to see that going forward. on how this defense attacks and puts pressure on the quarterback when you're down, and getting a couple more blitzes, a couple more quarterback pressures on the quarterback when you're down going forward.
Yeah, and I think you brought up a great point, too, about who's going to step up as a leader. Who's going to be that guy, right? And what I'm really talking about on defense, that guy that says, hey, if we call an X stunt, me or that guy's getting to the quarterback or the ball carrier.
Exactly.
If you call a blitz off the edge with me and I'm Tenelius Tatum, I'm getting to the quarterback, or he's going to be hurried to the point that he's going to throw it at a guy's feet, or it's going to be a pick. Let's call this play. And from what you're saying, and I believe it, like we didn't see that yesterday. Maybe we've had some of it at some point during the season, but you know, we need some of that. Looking up through the chat here, Mark Cruz. Yeah, we talked about this last night. Like, it doesn't really matter whose fault it is to me, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
If it's the players, if it's the coaches, first of all, I don't think it's some kind of mutually exclusive thing. Like, why does it have to be one or the other? Whatever the problem is, fix it. That's all that matters to me.
And Brent Key even said, you can't point one individual finger at the offensive line, defensive side of the ball. You can't point any finger wrong. I mean, obviously, offense didn't do well. Defense didn't do well. There was a turnover on special teams on the punt. Now, I mean, all three phases had something went wrong.
By the way, we didn't see that punt. Can you tell us what happened with the punt?
Yeah, so what happened was the snapper, I mean, as they went to close that gap where the wall is behind, right in front of the punter, the middle guy closed that gap a little too soon. It hit off his leg and just rolled, and fortunately Bowling Green was able to respond and just fall right on the football. And you know, it's just one of those moments where it rarely happens. I mean, it never really happens. And I guess he thought the snap was going a little bit earlier than expected, and so he went to go close that gap, and when he did, he realized, hey, I jumped too early to close that gap, and it turned up being in a turnover. So yeah, that punt was, you know, very crucial turning point in the game for Bowling Green, because they were able to get points off of it. I mean, great field position for them. They were in Georgia Tech territory, and so they were able to capitalize on it, I think by a touchdown late in that second quarter. So a
lot of nevers, you know, with Tech when it comes to that stuff.
Yeah, so it rarely ever happens, but when it does, turnovers like that turn into points very quickly.
No, that it rarely happens to anyone but Tech. I mean, we have four punts blocked throughout the first four games last year, and then we couldn't, you know, particularly put it to bed even when Brent Key took over. And this year, I've been watching it and been thinking it's only a matter of time, you know, because every time Shanahan gets a punt, man, it is like unnecessarily close, and I've just been waiting for it to happen. And I don't know what is wrong with our special teams, like, to where we can't, you know, protect. Is he taking too long to punt it, or we can't get the right protection? I feel like it's, you know, a little bit of both. And why didn't we fix that over the offseason? And, you know, that's gonna bite us in horrible moments, and it did. So,
I guess to try and inject a little positivity, I mean, I know we're down. Ben, if you had to pick a player on offense and defense that's going to be that guy that steps up as a leader and pushes everyone to be better, what two players would that be in your opinion?
I'd say on offense, I think probably the biggest one's Haynes King. I think when you watched his presser, you could tell he was visibly upset with the way things went on Saturday. Was very short in some of his answers and said, you know, they just need to be better. And, I mean, he was flat out answering questions, honestly. You know, he's not beating around the bush. You could tell, you know, he wanted to be on the other end of the scoreboard. And, you know, he was visibly upset with just the way things happened. And if there's anybody to be a leader and step up and be a vocal guy on the offense, it's your quarterback. And that's who you want leading your group. I would say on the defensive side, Zeke Biggers. I don't think we're talking about him enough and how the things that he's been able to do on the defensive line, he creates so much havoc. And I know that's a Jeff Collins saying, and I'm so sorry, but he creates havoc on the defense. And he's able to pressure the quarterback a lot more this year than he has in years past. He's so much faster off the ball. He's just able to use his size to his advantage, which is something that we really didn't see last year or early in his freshman campaign. And that's something we're starting to see this year, is he's being able to use his size to be able to use that to his benefit, because he is bigger than some of the offensive linemen that he's going up against right there at center or even those inside guards. So, I mean, it's impressive what he's been able to do with his size and his athleticism. But he's been able to get to the quarterback a lot this year than what he's been able to do in the past 2 years he's been at Georgia Tech.
I heard that. Oh, I just saw your thing. So Ben will be here till about 9, which we're rolling right up on. After Benjamin gets off, we'll take some calls. I definitely want to hear what you guys have to say. Mark Cruz says not Paul Mola. That was what I was going to say with I'm not picking on him, but he seems to be consistently the one giving answers that make me really upset. Like, it wasn't just this press conference. Just like, oh, yeah, man, we just kind of.
Was it the South Carolina State conference that press conference you were mad with, too? I could probably see that one.
I've been mad at so many. I don't remember exactly what he said. But, yeah, it was kind of the same thing where it's like, yeah, I mean, we just kind of weren't putting enough effort in, or, you know, we need to do this or that. Yeah. And it's like, well, do that. Just do it. You don't have to talk about it. Just do it.
Yeah, and I think he's like if I'm right, and I'd have to go back and look, he's a fifth-year senior, graduate senior, transferred out of Notre Dame. Yeah, so, I mean, he's rolling in on some veteran talent. And, you know, Georgia Tech brought him in to kind of fill that hole in the linebacker spot. And you want a guy like that who's had a lot of experience with a lot of different schools to come in there and compete and be one of the best linebackers you've had. To kind of fill that void. And, you know, with excuses like that, I mean, I'm not saying, and I'm not trying to throw him under a bus. I'm not. He's a very athletic kid, very great, humble young man. But when you come up with excuses like that, and it's kind of like you're beating a dead horse. I mean, you're saying the same thing over and over and over and not doing anything about it. So, because it happened in the South Carolina State game where they mentioned a couple of comments of, you know, the tackling issue. That they had in the South Carolina State game. He mentioned almost the same exact answer here, and it's just kind of concerning where you're like, hey, I mean, you gave the same answer 2 weeks ago, you know, and you may have fixed it a little bit at Wake Forest, but not enough to where it was noticeable. So how do you make sure it's noticeable next week against Miami? That's the biggest question I'm going to look for, you know, going into next week, saying, hey, how do they respond to – tackling, and how did they work on that this week, and did they focus on it at all? Is it a point of emphasis going forward? And Brent Keeble say, yeah, obviously, and I think, you know, as a head coach, you're going to say that, but how do you make it a point of emphasis going in this Miami game? That's the thing I'm going to be looking for next week when they go down to Miami.
Yeah. Sea Dog, do you have anything to say about Paul Mola and some of these interviews, or?
I mean, I don't know. From what I've seen from him, it just doesn't seem to be it. So, you know, I mean, I don't know. I think some of these players, you know, probably have a mindset that's not so easily changed, and there might be some weeding out needing to be done. My mind goes back to when Sarkisian takes over at Texas. And, you know, there was some, you know, cultural and mindset issues in the locker room there that he had to weed out. He had to get his guys in there, and he had to, you know, change the culture. Remember that leaked video of the coach yelling at them about how if you're not going to get with this, then transfer out. That I feel like some of that needs to happen, because I don't feel like that it's to where now that it's recurring. I understand it happening once and you build on it, and you're, you know, it doesn't happen again. But the like the tackling, like that, that's recurring. Like we talked about earlier, the you know, getting comfortable, that's recurring. You know, not doing your best to prepare every week. Well, if there's guys here that won't, that can't do that, well, there probably needs to be some weeding out done. So, who those guys are, I don't know. The coaches know, and if you know, there's going to be somebody out there that's going through the motions or whatever, and just, you know, not doing every rep to their best ability, but they have more talent or whatever. I'd rather have a guy who's just not good, but he gives his effort every play. You know, I'd much rather see that. You know, I'd much rather see that. So, I don't know. I feel like there should be. I feel like I might keep. I might want to see. Damn, might want to see a bit of a shake up in the depth chart there. That's kind of what I'll be looking out for.
Yeah, I imagine we'll see that with Sherrer taking over. Well, Ben, I know you got to hop off. What do you got coming up, and anything you want to say before you head out?
Yeah, I think one of the things that you know, Kelly Quinlan and Russell Johnson did today, they reached out to some of the recruits in the 2024 class, and Aaron Filo was one of them. You know, and with the loss like that, you're going to see a lot of decommitments. But from what Aaron Filo said, you know, he's locked in. He wants to help change the culture. And that's exactly what you want in this next class coming in, yeah, and saying, hey, you know, you want to keep them locked in. This is probably one of the best recruiting classes that we've seen in a little some time. Yeah. I mean, Aaron Filo has just been balling out in the state of Georgia. If you haven't seen his stats this year, just go on Max Preps, look it up, and it is absolutely – it will change your life. You know, and what the things that he's been able to do. And, you know, he had that first loss Saturday against, I want to say it was Mary Parsons, I think. It's a Catholic school near Atlanta. And, you know, suffering that first loss for him, he's like, I understand, you know, when things go wrong and things don't go your way. Coming off a state title for him last year. And, you know, he's able to come back and show what – you know, what mistakes they made last week are going to be fixed this week, going into this week. So he understands that things go wrong and people have bad games. And he's keeping this 2024 class and 2025 class, you know, in good standing with Georgia Tech. So a lot of these 2024 recruits still have great things to say about the staff. You know, I think if Thacker does leave, I think it would be interesting to see how much it impacts this class because of how much he helped recruit this class. You know, but going forward, I think this 2024 class can help boost some confidence going in to this 2024 season, excuse me. So it should be fun, but, you know, we got to make it through the rest of this year. And don't count Georgia Tech out. I think if they fix these things and get the small things corrected, they're going to be able to compete in some of these games like Miami, North Carolina, Clemson, Georgia. They'll be able to compete because a lot of these teams that we just mentioned, they're having down years. And you know, their record may not show it, but, you know, Georgia, you know, they hung in there with Auburn. And I think Georgia Tech and Auburn were in similar situations to begin the year. So, I mean, so I wouldn't count Georgia Tech out. It's just a few small things that they need to fix. And limit the big plays and limit the mistakes, and they'll be right on their way. But on JoeJackets.com, we're going to be talking with some of the guys who just got offered this past Saturday. So be on the lookout for that on JoeJackets.com. We'll kind of talk about, you know, some of the things that were said in the pressers between Paul Maiola, Dominic Blaylock, Haynes King. I know, I can never get his last name right. And who else? Oh, I'm sorry. And Lamas Brooks. Those were the four guys that represented in the presser. We'll kind of break that down for you guys on GoJackets.com. And then we get ready for Miami as Garrett Chapman talks with some of the guys down there to give us a preview on what to expect from Miami and Georgia Tech this weekend.
All right, well, that's awesome. Guys, go follow Benjamin London on Twitter. Go to GoJackets. He does fantastic work covering Georgia Tech over there. Ben, thank you so much for coming on and talking shop with us.
Anytime, guys. And hopefully we can have our spirits revived this weekend if we can get a win. So hopefully that's what we can pray for. But thank you guys for allowing me to join. Go Jackets.
All right, everyone. That was Benjamin London. I do see a homeless Jeff in the back room here. We're going to take some calls. Just Georgia Tech fans tonight. I do another live show where we open it up to other fan bases. Just click the StreamYard link there and come in and tell us what you think about Georgia Tech, about the DC change and the Bowling Green game. Let me switch screens here because Lord knows I've been burnt before.
Hey, real quick, shout out to everybody I got to see at the game. I really enjoyed getting to see, like, if somebody comes up and says, yo, C-Dog, I love, you know, or WreckTalk, I'm sure, and yep. Loves it too. You know, it's really awesome to talk to you guys. So love freaking seeing you guys and hanging out, getting to talk with you. I got to see a few of you this weekend, and that was really cool. I was standing up there absolutely fuming, and you know where I was at, right?
In the all corner. The top of the north end zone or the well, north stands.
It was in the very corner in section 210. It was like the north end, northwest. Of the end zone at the very top. And I was standing up there, and you know, there's a gap between that and then the home sideline. There's like this big gap. And I look over and there's somebody like waving at me. And I look over and he's like waving and he goes, and I'm like,
well, yeah, I do want to hear from you. After a loss like that might not be the best time to approach us, though.
Well, talking to you people does help. So I thank you for
absolutely.
I thank you for saying what's up to me. If you see me in public, don't be afraid to come up and say what's up, because I love talking to you guys. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, we can't get enough of it.
It makes my day, really.
100%. We have two people in the back room. I'll take these in the order that y'all came in. Mark, I see you in here as well. You'll be next. Homeless Andrew Thacker. Well, I don't think you can say that yet. What's going on, man?
Hey, how's it going? Well, I think it's safe to say that if we have any prayer of making a bowl, which is like a pretty far afterthought, we're going to have to absolutely steal games now. Like, there's no question about it. We're going to have to absolutely steal North Carolina and Syracuse. We're going to have to steal both of those.
Yeah.
And that's a tough, really tough task. But, you know, just talking about the next game, I mean, you kind of saw it last year with the Pitt game.
Yeah.
Brent Key made some drastic changes in just a week, but you know, now you make a coordinator change midseason. I think it's going to be interesting to see like what the new defensive coordinator does. If I was Kevin Sherrer personally, especially at the linebacker position, I would say everything's open. Who wants it?
Yeah,
that would be my first order of business. Everything's open. Who wants it? You have to win the job this week. And if you do, I mean, like every week, who wins the job? That should be the mindset. There should be no, for a defense as bad as we are. I mean, and other than maybe Kyle Kennard and Jalen King, we have no playmakers on defense. None. Like, no guy that you can just point to and be like, if that guy gets to the ball, he will make the tackle. Like, there's nobody on defense that you can just point to, and other than maybe Kyle Kennard and Jalen King. Lamiles Brooks, you thought Lamiles Brooks was going to be that guy. And it's just like, you're just throwing your hands up in the air, wondering what the heck is going on with him. He has zero interceptions through five games. Two of those games have been South Carolina State and Bowling Green. I mean, obviously we lost to Bowling Green, but those are supposed to be our cupcakes. And you can't even get a single interception through five games, and you're supposed to be that guy, all ACC. Like, everyone was saying in Georgia Tech forums and whatnot that they thought he would be all ACC, potentially all American, and he hasn't done anything.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. The thing is, yeah, we did make a lot of changes in 1 week going into Pitt, but those were changes that Key wasn't a part of implementing. From the standpoint of, like, he didn't create the problems that he was fixing. And I'm not necessarily saying it's 100% on him now, but he's been the guy for, you know, almost a year now. Or no, he has been the guy a year. So it's not quite, I think, the same thing. And I kind of like what Mike Doug says. I can't remember the last time a middle-of-the-season DC change has worked. Same with the offense last year. We pretty much did that with Chip Long and Chris Winkie. And the offense, though it did play better, wasn't substantially better. So that being said, I don't really know what to expect with the changes. But, yeah, I do agree with what you're saying that, I mean, we had a come-to-Jesus talk before Wake, so I guess that's out. Maybe we need to have a come-to-Yahweh talk, or we can just keep running through the different ones. But something to say, hey, this is not acceptable. We're going to find out who wants to go this week and every week following.
I mean, and the sad thing about it is it's not like, you know, our defensive issues are like, you know, a DB gets burned by a really, really good wide receiver and they break off a couple big plays every game. And that's our defense's issue, is that our DBs can't cover very well, or they can't. No, it's they can't make tackles. They can't get any push on the defensive line. They can't generate turnovers. I mean, any problem, you name it, we have an issue in that area of defense. I mean, the generating turnovers part was the part that pissed me off the most. Bowling Green was averaging 4 turnovers a game, and we got 0. Well, how is that possible?
I think that's part to blame for our missed tackles, is we kind of have it in our minds that, well, last year we were this defense that was able to rip the ball out and create all these turnovers. And if you look at a lot of missed tackles, it's where we're tackling with our arm, trying to knock the ball out, and we don't, and then the guy gets a bunch of yards after contact. So we might need to put, like I said last night, address things in the order they're killing you. Okay, turnovers is now way down the list. You just need to make the tackle at the point of contact. Could give a shit about getting a turnover at the moment. Just make the tackle.
Or at least, you know, have him in your grasp long enough to get a second guy there to then bring him down. But it's like they're just completely brushing by. So it's like they're getting to the second and third level before any guy even gets to them.
Yeah, I think it was Slim that was saying that Miami has like a ton of yards after contact. And they've been breaking tackles like crazy. So
now I've watched some film on them. And if you think Louisville did us dirty with that, Miami's better. And yeah, they're substantially better.
We're going to get destroyed. I don't even want to watch that crap.
Well, I mean, who knows? But go ahead.
And the other thing, the main issue that I have with just the mindset of this team is, I know you have already addressed it, I think, a couple times, but Paul Moala said it. He said that certain players on the team were not taking it seriously, so they essentially overlooked an opponent. How are you in any position to overlook any opponent when you are 2-3? Or you're 2-2.
Yeah.
You're not 4-0. We're not even talking about in the scope of the last few years. We're talking about right now. Even, you know, yes, we beat Wake, but we're 2-2. We're not 4-0. We didn't pull off anything against Ole Miss or Louisville. Like, if we had won those games and, you know, beaten, you know, South Carolina State and Wake handily, then maybe you might be in a position to overlook an opponent. But you're 2-2, and your defense is not good. Like, you're not good. And how are you in any position to overlook an opponent? I just don't understand how you get that mindset. And this is just me venting, but that pissed me off the most out of anything that was said in any of the pressers, more than anything with Key. And it's just like, if your players are overlooking an opponent and you're not setting them straight, that's a coaching problem. Why are they doing that? That's coaching.
Yeah, I can't make sense of it either. And yeah, I mean, I had said that before too. I don't know how you overlook an opponent, but homeless Andrew, I appreciate you coming on. We got some more people waiting to get on. Appreciate it, man. Mark Cruz, I know you've been in the chat a good bit lately. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing good. How are y'all?
Doing horrible, if you want an honest answer, man.
You know what? I don't know why I said that, because that's not true either. I guess it's just a cue, but
yeah.
Well, no, I mean, go ahead.
No, you go ahead. What do you got for us tonight? What do you think?
Well, I know I've been in the chat quite a bit talking about, you know, blame versus the players and the coaches and whatnot.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, I got to be honest with what the last guy was saying who was on here. I really don't agree. I don't feel like we have to steal, you know, anything from any other team to try and get a win, because I really do feel like this team has a lot of talent. Mm-hmm. I mean, I keep seeing that over and over again. I mean, when we're good, when we're at our best, we're actually really good. You know, it's not like last year where we're just like scraping along. I see a lot of talent, especially with the offense and Haynes King.
You know, I think you're hitting the nail on the head too. And that's what's so frustrating about this, is because I know it's under there. I know that we have the capability of it, and we just haven't, even when we win, we're getting in our own way so much, and it's like, it's so frustrating. But I know what you mean, but we're just held back too much by these issues, that and it's really coming to a head, and I just don't know if we can overcome that. I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see how we respond to this, but you know, we could be it could be a total cashing in, and you know, but if this team plays like it's capable of, yes, we can absolutely whoop some teams. Yeah. And especially it'll be out of nowhere, because they won't expect a team that got blown out by Bowling Green to turn around and whoop them. But
right. Yeah,
we are capable of it. I completely agree.
Yeah, and it depends on what he means by steal. I mean, it will be an upset, most likely. Upset.
By the odds.
But, yeah, I also agree with you that, look, this is not an untalented team that's not capable of playing very well. And to C-Dog's point, that's what's so incredibly frustrating, is that we know what we're capable of doing, and we are, for whatever reason, playing well below that. And it's not just well below it, it's like just very fundamental things are not happening, and it's head scratching.
It's a mental block of sorts that this team has, is what I feel like it is. It's too hard for them to get out of the mindset that they've been in for 4 years. And I think that, yeah. I honestly believe that's, it's like a huge mental thing with them.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I was thinking about yesterday. When y'all were talking, because I was saying, you know, how many of these guys are left over from the Jeff Collins era? And that's why I keep talking about the players, because if I look, you know, maybe I'm crazy, but I really do like Brent Key. I really like, you know, the responses that he's giving. Now, obviously, this is not the outcome that you want, but he's taking the blame. And I mean, he is making moves. He is doing things. Obviously, what he said to the players in that whatever conference they had right before the Wake Forest game, obviously, that had some impact. But to me, it seems a lot like the players just aren't responding. And that's what I'm saying, because I see so much talent in this team. I don't understand why the players aren't responding to that. I mean, I totally agree with what you were saying earlier, C-Dog, and that, like, I'd much rather have somebody who's going to give a full effort, even if they're just not that good, than, you know, what I'm seeing right now. And honestly, even last year, at the end of last year, that's what I felt like I was seeing, is I saw a lot of effort from our players, but I didn't see a whole lot of talent. And now I feel like it's kind of the opposite, where we've got a lot of transfers who are really talented players, but I'm not seeing the same level of, you know, grit and focus.
Yeah, it's hard to say, like, how much of that culture is still left over, or maybe, you know, we've been using the word mindset a lot, but yeah, I don't know how much of it is kind of left over, to your point. It's hard to say. And I don't think you're crazy for saying Brent Key is a good coach, or that, you know, you're still kind of behind Brent Key, because you are. The reason we were so high on Georgia Tech was his body of work as the interim. And again, that's why this is so frustrating.
Well, you know, just every team nowadays, is coaches get fired left and right. And I feel like, you know, that's what the athletic directors will do, just to say, oh, we're going to fix the problem. You know, we're not doing well. We're just going to fire the coach. And, like, I mean, I'm not saying it's never the coach's fault. Certainly it is. Obviously with Collins, it was. But I just feel like, you know, guys like Brent Key, I really feel like he could become a good coach. But, you know, it just depends on how much of a leash we're willing to give him. But I mean, again, just these college athletes, you said, you know, recently you would never question the heart of any of these players.
Yeah.
And, you know, initially I totally agreed with you too. I don't know really right now. It's kind of confusing, but I will say, I mean, I know there are definitely some players on this team who want to compete. You know, I have a sister who's a college athlete, and I know, you know, how much these people who don't get to play want to play, and they're hungry for it. So I definitely agree with the point the last guy was making, that, you know, every spot should be open, because there's got to be somebody on this team who, you know, is going to give it 100%.
Yeah, and I said that, and you said you listened last night, like when I was talking with Joe Gilbert. Like, it's just head scratch. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't understand being, you know, not just a Division One player, but a Power Five player, you know, in the ACC, and not, and like lacking heart. Like, that just kind of doesn't compute for me. Like, that's never even something I'm considering in the equation. And then yesterday happens, and I'm like, well, I mean, damn, guys, like, y'all are going to make me take an L on everything that I've said. So, yeah, I understand what you're saying. Like, it does seem like there's some lack of an intangible like that, though. I will say that.
Yeah, I mean, I cannot stand what Paul Moa said. That's going to bother me until, I hope that gets addressed. I don't want to see him on the field. Like, I know that, you know, that maybe that's a little far, but I cannot stand somebody saying, we weren't giving it enough effort. We just have to, and in such a casual tone too. He's not even, didn't seem to sound mad at himself.
So. No, he seemed like, yeah, we're just going to go to Subway after this. No big deal. Like, everything's fine. Yeah. I don't think that that's out of decorum or something to say, like, because he's done it twice now. So, like, if I'm a coach, I'm like, all right, first of all, never say that again. Second of all, you're not going to play. Like, I don't think that's out of line. But we've got a few more people in here, Mark. I appreciate you coming in, talking shop with us.
Appreciate it, man.
Yo, can I ask y'all one more question real quick?
Sure.
Okay, so y'all were both at the game, right?
Yes.
Fortunately.
Okay, on the broadcast, y'all have to go back and watch this. I'll let y'all go, but
oh, God.
They were saying,
I don't want to go back and watch that.
I'll watch it. I have to for a film.
God dang.
No, I just, there was something, if you catch it, there was something they were saying towards the beginning of the game about Andrew Thacker and how he was super stressed out. I don't know if it was for this game or something. Okay, so maybe you already caught it.
His daughter made him a stress ball or something.
I was just curious what that was about. I was so confusing.
What?
It's pretty bizarre, man. First of all, like, how did that get out? Because if it did, it makes you think that was some bit of information Tech gave or something. Like, I have no idea why you would say, yeah, man, this guy's so stressed out. Like, he's his daughter's making a stress doll for him. Like, what is that? Why do we need to know that? How does that?
I mean, I feel sorry for the guy, but that's obviously not what you want to hear.
No, so. You never want to hear, like, yeah. You know, your defensive coordinator's so stressed out, his daughter's trying to help him. No, I don't want to hear that from my defensive coordinator.
That's very odd. I have no idea what. I feel like that's something I would have heard, even not watching the broadcast.
That sounds like a conspiracy theory.
Yeah.
That sounds like a Reddit post.
And it was like they were like making a whole thing about it. They had a picture of it on the screen, and
were they framing it as like, oh, like,
yeah, I think so. But then, you know, our defense performed horrible, so it just looked really bad, and I honestly just felt bad for the guy.
He thinks he's gonna make him another one now that he's been demoted. Goodness. Like, yeah, that aged poorly. Well, all right, man, I appreciate it.
Right.
That's absolutely insane. I did hear about that though.
I had no idea, dude. That's crazy.
Now you're gonna have to help me with this name. What's going on, man? How do we say your name?
Oh, you can call it Sob.
Sob. First 4 letter.
Yes, that works.
All right, man. Well, what do you think? What do you got for us tonight?
All right. I'm first time joining this call. I graduated in March 2020.
Congratulations. From
Tech and always attended pretty much all home games. And being in Knoxville, Tennessee, I skip Tennessee games and rather watch GT game at home. Anyhow.
Oh, man, that's fantastic, but also tough for you. What was your program, by the way, of study?
I was in civil engineering with hydrology, and now I'm at Oak Ridge, this Oak Ridge National Lab.
So you were in Mason Building?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. I'm familiar. Go ahead.
Wow. Awesome. First of all, I also caught what that person was saying about commentators making the statement that Andrew Tucker was stressed about the offense of Bowling Green and the variety of like plays they have. And I was like, why would someone tell that they're stressed about like opposite team's offense? That was really, really weird. So I also caught, even if I was like casually watching this stuff, weird. Second, I was thinking the same thing that, well, okay, defense is bad, we know it. What's about offense? Because that did not give good confidence. And I was thinking that maybe there's something bad there. Maybe we don't, it's not as good as I was thinking. But today, listening to some conversation, I realized that maybe we are missing what they call as complementary play. Like defense got a huge advantage in first two drives. Like you were 14 points up and your offensive players see how shitty your defense is, like literally like playing very bad tackle, and that totally drains the momentum. They basically lose the spark they have. So I think that could be it, not playing the complementary. And like I don't know a lot of like technical stuff, but I realized that Andrew Tucker's defense was a bit gimmicky. Like very weak on fundamentals, but trying to get interceptions and trying to rip ball off and not focusing on like tackles was, and their gimmicks worked few times. When they worked, they were seen pretty good, but you know, it's not consistent, right? If you're relying on gimmicks and stuff like that. So yeah, that's pretty much my observation. Again, I'm not too informed about technicalities, but
no, I think you make a good point. Like, you use the word gimmick, but if by gimmick you mean like we're focused on stripping the ball out instead of making a tackle, I 100% agree with that.
Exactly.
As far as scheme, I don't think it's gimmicky. I mean, almost every team in the country now runs a nickel with that 4-2 front. But, yeah, I don't – I am kind of heartbroken for Andrew Thacker because this is a what have you done for me lately game that we're in. And he did a very good job last year. And I'll say this. We talked about people saying Collins is comparable to Key. The thing is, Collins would never have made a change like this. And we'll see how it pans out. I don't know. Go ahead, C-Dog.
Do you think Tucker got this opportunity slightly early? Like, do you think he needed a little bit more grooming in terms of being off like defensive coordinator? Was it too early, you think?
Oh, did he? I mean, need he has the potential. Time?
Well, I thought. Yeah. Well, he brought, you know, when he came in with Jeff Collins, because he's been here 5 years. When he came in with Jeff Collins, yes, but he's got so much experience now and so much time as defensive coordinator as the program. No, I thought giving him the job last year was a good thing to do, because, you know, his defense really took off once we fired Jeff Collins. And so I was totally on board with it. And then another thing I wanted to talk about too, I had noticed too how kind of we're laser focused on the defense. But like you were saying earlier, you make a good point about the offense failing to show up too. And some people have mentioned it, but most of the focus is on the defense here. And I've thought of that too. And I sort of kind of worked it without bringing it up. I sort of kind of worked it out of my head, because you got to think, well, yes, the offense did put up 14 and then went to sleep for, you know, three quarters. And I think that the offense is focused on a lot because it's so much better than last year. It's like night and day. So you kind of expect there to be a period of rebuilding with the offense, and you kind of give them grace when it comes to, you know, when it comes to things like that, because we're not going to be like, we have an all new staff this year, a lot of new players on the offense. So I think you give them some grace based on that, because it's just a breath of fresh air to see we have an actual, like, decent, competent offense. Yes, they still should be held accountable because we're reverting back to last year's kind of standards on offense when we no-show for three quarters. Like, that's not okay. And we should be able to score on Bowling Green no matter what. But I think, when you look at the defense, they're focused in on, because they're worse than last year, and they've really fallen off. And also, their overall play has been more detrimental. It's kind of like roles switched from last year, because our defense carried us a lot of the games last year. This year, the offense is the ones that have really bailed us out a lot. So I think that's kind of why they get the benefit of the doubt here. But yeah, it is, I mean, totally not cool. Nothing about yesterday's game was acceptable in any way.
No. And I know Saab brought up a math term. So yeah, we're like an inverse team this year. But Saab, man, congratulations on that tech degree. That's going to take you a long way.
Oh yeah.
In this world. Appreciate you calling in, man.
Yeah. Thank you. Pleasure.
Have a good one.
I wish we'd have got to met on better circumstances.
Yeah, I wish the first call was like a win over Miami or something.
Yeah.
PD, so I seen you drop out a few times. How are you doing, sir?
I'm pretty good. I'm at the airport, so if it's too much background noise, let me know.
No, you're good, but, man.
I'm in Houston heading to New Orleans, but I guess what I'm going to say on all of this is we got to remember we are rebuilding.
Yeah.
We talked in the past, you and I was on your show now, a couple months ago.
Yeah.
And I was graduated 91, and people forget, everybody talks about, oh, we went to the championship in 1990. Yeah, but we went won two games the first year, won three games the next year. You know, then we had a stronger year. And I just think a lot of it is, not to sound talking down to the youngsters, but, you know, we want the satisfaction and the results now. And that's just the world we live in. We do. So we are so much better than we were last year. But don't get me wrong. I was, I think, yelling as much as Sea Dog and you were, Rhett, at the TV yesterday.
Yes.
And I couldn't. It was bad. But then I had to calm down and just remember where we were at last year. Especially when I saw the damn picture of him with the Georgia folks with those capri pants on he had again. We are so far ahead.
So. Yeah, I think it's pretty mature to be able to look at it and say, yeah, you got to kind of take a step back and look at the big picture, because it is, after all, year one for Brent Key. I think a lot of people, including myself, really had such high expectations because
you know, he was the interim and took over, retained a lot of staff, retained a lot of players, and kind of expected that continuity to really play a big role. And I think it has. I think that we are a better team than if we had, for example, hired Willie Fritz, you know? If we had hired out, it would have been a complete rebuild. There's no telling the lows that we would have reached this season. So we do have that benefit is the continuity. But yeah, I was saying, that also ties into kind of what I was saying about this team and some mindset needs to change, because some of these things are surfacing. It is a mindset and a mental thing and a culture thing that all of the players need to adopt and realize that.
But you look at the skill set of our
anymore. Yeah.
Yeah. If you look at the skill set of our, and you're right though, 100%, because everybody, I've read a lot of posts that people are saying, well, this isn't Brinkley's first year, it's his fourth year. Well, bullshit, it's not. It's his first year.
It's head coach. That's worlds different.
Look at our yeah. But our linebackers, they're average at best right now.
Yeah.
So I don't know what we're expecting from them. They just get run over constantly.
Out of
part
position.
Of it is not just coaching, it's talent there. We do not have, yes, out of position, and when you break it down, you were showing it, it's a lot of that stuff. You just, you know, sometimes are getting to it, but more than not, they're not. And they are just, I don't know what Kevin Sherrer is going to bring to it, because we still have a talent gap at definitely at linebacker.
Yeah.
Yeah, and when you look at it on film, a few things. So when you look at it on film, and this is what is really painful to watch, by the time the linebacker identifies where the ball is, it's 5 yards behind him. And that's not acceptable.
Absolutely.
The other thing, I don't think you're talking down to the young guys at all. I mean, the people who are telling me to off myself yesterday were talking down to me, but you're certainly not. And I think you're right. I mean, look, I am a little bit more immature in my response, because I have to come on here, C-Dog and I, week after week and kind of defend it, and then we do our trash talk thing. So, yeah, I want results now. But you're absolutely right. We are building for the future. I do think Brent Key is the right guy for that, especially from the standpoint of, I think Brent Key is one of the only guys that we could hire that if we had any semblance of success, and I'm not talking bad about George O'Leary, but you get a guy like George O'Leary and he goes to Notre Dame, he's gone. I don't think that's what we have with Brent Key. I think he loves Georgia Tech from the bottom of his heart. And we might just have a painful first year with him at helm, and we need to be a little bit patient with that.
All right. I appreciate you taking my let me talk on the screen yard. I'm going to catch a flight here.
Yeah, we appreciate you calling in.
Yeah, man. Have a safe flight there out of Houston. I've flown out of Houston before. I actually took Spirit Air, which I'll never – ever do again, and it was absolutely terrifying.
I've never been west of Alabama.
I'm gonna pretend like I didn't know that. What's going on, man? Welcome on the show.
Yo, what's up, Wreck Talk and Sea Dog? It's been a while. Sorry, I didn't come on here until much later. Just got done doing a few things.
Never be sorry. What you got?
So just kind of wanted to talk about, you know, last night a little, or yesterday's game, because it was a very hard game to go through, especially as a diehard Tech fan. But I thought we looked really good the first, like, two drives. But then for some reason, the 38 unanswered points is what's really, you know, devastating, you know. Like, yeah. I don't get it. I don't get how we can go from, like, dominating Wake Forest. I mean, we didn't dominate them because, I mean, they almost came back. But winning against Wake Forest to basically throwing this game away. Like, I don't get how you can do that. to be honest.
Well, I wouldn't say we threw it away. I mean, Bowling Green just came out and whooped our asses. I mean, it wasn't like there was, you know, we one pass that they hit on us or something like that. I know what you're saying, by the way. But, and yeah, even with Wake Forest, we didn't dominate, though we should have. I mean, if you go look at every game that you're plus five turnover margin or plus four, I would guess the margin of victory is usually three touchdowns or more. So maybe that should have tipped the hand to us that something was awry, but yeah.
Yeah. I feel the same way. I feel like we should have dominated Wake Forest, especially seeing the score at halftime of that game. I believe they had scored like 13 unanswered on us until, you know, they threw that interception. Other than that, you know, it was a nail-biting game.
Yeah, we need to pay our phone bill because we're not answering the call very often.
Yes, we can just not dominate a team. This happened with Duke last year too, and it's like,
yeah,
watch out if we ever figure out how to play to our maximum potential all the time, because we're like scary good. I mean, I've seen it three times since Brent Key took over against Duke. We just dominated, blew them out. You know. We were completely in control. Let them screw around. Let them come back. Got in our own way. Same with Louisville. We dominated them, kicked their ass in the first quarter or first half, and then, you know, got too big of a head and let them come back. Same against Wake Forest. That was a nail biter. I mean, God forbid we ever figure out what we're doing and you know, play to our potential, because we could be seriously scary. It drives me insane. I want to see that team. That's the team I thought I would see this year, but
yeah, it kind of drives me crazy too, because I believe I had us going like 7-5.
Yeah, and now to be honest, 4. That's 8-4. Not looking so good now.
Yeah, I don't know about this loss. I think that the ceiling now is an upset, like, and then a bowl, because I don't even know. Yeah. I don't know about the Miami game. I think we dropped that game, to be honest. But
has the line been released yet? It's got to be at what the line against us in Bowling Green was.
Yeah, I think it's 16 when I checked last.
I didn't think we were going to win that game even before the Bowling Green game. No, I really don't.
Yes. I had us winning against Miami, but I was like very unconfident about it. Like
in the off season, I thought it, but once I started watching Miami play, I was like, "Uh-oh." Now of course, when Miami fans start talking to me and start talking trash, I tell them that we're gonna kick their teeth in. But I mean, that's just what I gotta do. You know?
Yeah, Miami is Miami's probably the team that I hate the most besides UGA.
Yeah, they're good, and they're good. As much as I hate to say it, they are. I think we lose, and I think we probably get our ass kicked, to be honest.
Well, of the seven games we have left to play, we'll be underdogs in at least five of them, and we need four more wins. So, yeah, it's tough.
I'm searching up the point spread now.
I didn't see it earlier. I was looking through them earlier.
From Play Picks, Miami's a 19-point favorite.
That makes sense.
19 points. Okay. Yeah. That sounds about right. But I hit a nine leg parlay this past weekend, by the way.
How'd that go?
It was great. Really? Not really, though, because I took a bunch of teams on the money line and got to where it was like I took
Hold
like
on,
Michigan.
Dude. You parlayed money line bets?
Yeah. I'm a degenerate.
What?
I'm a degenerate. I parlayed like Penn State, Michigan, like Alabama on the money line. Yeah, I hit it, dude.
Oh, you took you parlayed favorites on the money line.
Yes, and yes, at like minus 1,000, minus 500, minus 2,000, and I took Penn State like minus 5,000.
Yeah, so if you don't know betting, that means he has to bet like $5,000 to make $10, you know?
Yeah, so I parlayed them all and hit it. I
you made your 40 bucks.
I don't usually bet, really. I was just screwing around, and I actually won it. I did it until it was like a decent payout, and then I hit, so I was stoked.
Okay, well, that's not as bad as I thought. I thought you parlayed dogs and money line, because you usually take another dog and money line. And I was like, oh, okay, so
you can parlay. I mean, you could parlay two dogs, and if you hit, then that's like a huge payout.
Yeah, it's probably like 1,000 to 1 or something.
Yeah, yeah. If you would have made a lot of money just betting on Bowling Green this past week.
Yeah, it was +850
Yeah, yeah. But I don't recommend doing what I did, because I did. One of them was Iowa, and they almost lost to Michigan State somehow. I was like, no way, dude. They've got Mel Tucker up there fired. They don't even have a coach. Like, there's no way that Michigan State wins, but they almost won. And I was like, well, there goes that. But no, that came through for me. So, I'm glad, just a side thing.
I'm glad you told everyone that. I actually have like a 8-month research video coming up with a friend from Philly that he's picking the spread based on his expert gambling knowledge. And I'm making the same picks based on a coin toss. And in 3 weeks, I'm winning.
Wow. Wow.
I don't even look at the teams. I just look at, like, game one, game two, game three, flip a coin, and I'm up, like, 20% on them.
That's wild. Yeah. That's crazy. Yeah, I just like to screw around sometimes. I don't really bet a lot. I sometimes just screw around and do stuff like that and see.
Are you saying that because Mrs. Sea Dog is in the background?
Yes. Stop calling me out on stuff like that. What the hell, man?
I've been in your shoes.
I really promise. I don't bet a lot. I just did it this past weekend. And I hit it. Okay? But I'll never do it again.
Sorry, man. Sorry about that. We kind of took over the... Yeah, I don't know if...
Yeah, sorry.
Sorry. I just came back from doing something again.
I'm too busy screwing around.
You screw around too much.
Yeah. I don't even know what you were talking about. I was using that.
Don't worry about it. It's irrelevant.
Yeah, we went from like 60 viewers to 12 in that conversation. But what else did you think, man? Give us one more thing. We're gonna move on to the next caller.
You know, all I want to say is I hope that we see, you know, a different team, you know, in the future. This we could just pretend like this game never existed. If we like beat Miami,
it's going to take a lot of mental fortitude for us to bounce back from this, to be honest.
Yeah.
I really hope that the players can walk the walk, because all you hear from them in the press conferences is, yeah. We put this game behind us and move on to the next week. We don't let it affect us, blah, 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 blah. Okay. Let's see that then. Cause I know what this team's capable of. I'll know for a fact if you're able to move on from this. I'll know for a fact.
100%.
So we'll see if they can do that.
I appreciate you coming on, GT fan. Thanks for calling in, man.
Appreciate you, man.
Now I do see Ethan13 in the chat. He says I've never been impressed with Thacker. Here's the you weren't impressed with him against North Carolina last year?
Yeah, dude. North Carolina was putting up 50 points on people, and Thacker shut that shit down.
T Branch of the $5 super chat says never forget that North Carolina game is absolutely right. 441W, what's going on, man? Welcome to the Georgia Tech live show.
How's it going, guys?
What's up?
Pretty shitty.
In fact, no. I just thought of that. Damn it! Now that we've demoted Thacker, I don't know if we can beat North Carolina. Damn it! He was their kryptonite, dude.
Well, he's still on staff though, and I think that might be enough.
I hope they take some pointers from him or something.
Well, what do you think, 441W? What you got?
I mean, I was just going to – I agree with you guys. I think maybe the biggest thing holding us back right now is the mental side, because all the stuff about the talent gap, like, yeah, there's some truth to that to a degree. But from a results standpoint, we see them execute in ways that are spectacular on offense, like on defense against Wake. Like, dude, they do all that. And then they turn around and, you know, just look like they're completely lost and unprepared and, like, not in the same league.
I agree.
And that seems to mental.
Yeah.
I agree that in some spots it's execution, and in some spots I don't think we're quite as talented. Like I agree that the linebacker's definitely not as good as we've had, you know, in the past couple of years. But, like, we're just as talented on offense, for example. Maybe not particularly on the offensive line, but those guys play great for what they are. They play great, but, you know, we're talented at quarterback, talented at receiver, you know, maybe not tight end, but you know, I do agree that in some spots, particularly the linebackers and D-line, we're just not as good, and that's kind of what I've thought all year.
But here's the thing about the talent gap. That don't explain the secondary. There's not, like, all those kids are 4 stars. Lamiles Brooks was great last year. Clayton Powell Lee was great.
Yeah, and even that's an execution. That's an execution thing.
Even at linebacker, Trenilius Tatum was a 4-star.
Yeah.
You know, he struggled this year. I mean, that, to me, really only applies to the defensive line, maybe.
Yeah, those are great points. I wonder, it's difficult to validate, but to the culture point, and, like, who do we need to bring in here from a culture kind of standpoint, work ethic, I feel like there's a lot of guys maybe on this team, I don't know, that kind of, they prepare, and I think I agree with you, WreckTalk, like, they prepare, they put effort in, but I think they put effort in with the mindset of, like, I sure hope I'm successful, but maybe not, versus, like, I feel like truly champion type players, like truly elite players, they put that same effort in and that same preparation with a mental, like, they're terrified that they might lose. Like, they're worried that, like, hey, I have to put this work in, I have to prepare because this other team, they might beat us. Oh, I might, this running back might truck me even though he's from Bowling Green or whatever. I gotta be ready to play. And I don't know if we have that makeup and enough guys that are just like, you know, Brent Key said something in that very first press conference a year ago where he's like, we need guys that hate losing and not guys that just hope they win. And I wonder how much carryover there is of guys that just hope they win, which, you know, having other guys that are just like absolutely terrified that they might lose and will work as hard as they can to make sure it doesn't happen.
True, yeah, and even with practice, like, it's an old adage, it's not practice makes perfect, perfect practice makes perfect. And I don't know what goes on particularly defensively at practice, but yeah, you got to be practicing the right things. And it just makes me think, what have we done as far as tackling? What are we doing at practice that addresses the tackling? Because I would just be like, hey, we're going to do open field tackling drills. And if you tackle him in the open field, you know, you don't got to run wind sprints after practice. If he gets around you, he don't got to run wind sprints. We're going to find out.
Maybe this is a new thing. I don't know. But maybe we need to stop tackling those pads that look like Cheerios, because those things don't really try to push back when you hit them. And I see that a lot. But that doesn't help with a guy who was like, no, I'm going to try to run past you, not just fall over as soon as you hit me.
What do you mean with pads with, like, Cheerios?
On defense, you can see it in some of the video clips of practice. They have these big pads that are just giant foam rings, and they roll them, right?
You haven't
seen
those?
To me like,
WreckTalk, you haven't seen those?
No.
The big foam pads that you tackle? They're like big donuts.
It's like a truck tire, but
and they roll it, and then you try and the thing with the big foam donut is it can't cut, far as I can tell.
Exactly. Yeah, and it's not rolling towards you. It's rolling.
And
it's, you know, side to side.
It's not going. It's not going really fast.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I'm an electrical engineer. Maybe I could design a donut that can turn on a dime or something. Wouldn't that be great to see him chase this thing that's zigzagging like a bunny rabbit? Maybe that's what we need to do.
They made some robotic tackling dummies.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with you, man. I don't know. I don't think it's just a talent thing. Like, I don't know if it's just a mindset thing. I don't know, but I do know that there's something catastrophically wrong right now. And maybe a change at DC is moving in the direction of fixing it. I don't know. I don't.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, DC runs what scheme and practice and game plan, and then the coordinator does that. And then position coaches execute. So, I mean, maybe it's possible that Key thought he saw something he didn't like with Thacker's preparation or game planning or whatever, and hopefully share, you know, with a lot more sort of NFL and then, you know, high-level SEC-type experience can bring something different to that. But, I mean, we're complaining a lot about the execution and the talent of the linebackers who Sherrer was coaching before he took over as DC. So, I mean, I don't know if that's going to do a lot.
I don't either. 441W, we're coming to the end of the show. I appreciate you calling in, man. A lot of callers.
Yeah, man. Man.
Really appreciate it. We'll take one more. I don't recognize NJink 22. Before we get to him, T-Brant says Rocky chased a chicken. Now, someone hasn't seen that movie on the panel, but I know what you're talking about. NJink, what's going on, man?
How's it going, y'all? A long-time listener, first-time caller.
Awesome.
Yeah, man.
Just wanted to drop in and kind of speak. So I'm in college, but I don't go to Tech. My dad worked at Tech. Family went to Tech, whatever. Been a fan since, you know, since I was born. And really started watching consistently in around 2008 when Paul Johnson came in.
Okay.
I don't understand. So I went to the Louisville game earlier this year and had a great time, you know, up until the end. Something I noticed, and they were – I've seen people talking about it before, you know, throughout this season, you know, with the fans just not showing up and how embarrassing it is to have half the stadium empty until we play a big team and it's filled with, you know, everybody from their fan base. And for most of the season, I didn't really understand it because, you know, new coach, lots of excitement. I was surprised to see how. And I know y'all understand this because, you know, you've been to pretty much every game this year. And C-Dog, I know you've been going to a lot of them or trying to get to some of them.
Yeah, but I like streaming more, but yeah.
And for the most part, I do too. But I was wondering what y'all's perspective is on that. And just wanted to say, you know, I understand it now after yesterday. And one more thing,
you mean?
Yeah. Why this year there were so few fans? Like you could even tell on TV, you know, that there was nobody there, and it's a shame. And I didn't understand it up until yesterday, and you know, I'm probably the first college football fan to say, you know, I was glad I was at a wedding and did not have to watch this game. Funny enough, I watched the first two drives and turned it off. And lo and behold, you know, a couple hours later, I looked and about crap myself because I didn't hear anything about it. But I just wondered what y'all's perspective is on that.
Yeah, that happened to me last year. I was pissed because I wanted to go to the Miami game. Well, then I turned out to be glad I didn't go. But I can't say I blame them, to be honest. This is a huge debate right now, too, in the Tech. I've seen this go back and forth a lot for under Collins, you know. Are the fans to blame? You know, the players' parents seem to get really defensive and mad. You know, there's a lot of negativity and everything else. It's a huge debate. And it's a pretty complex answer,
You know what I mean? It's a pretty like complicated, because there's a lot that goes into it.
Right.
Look, after yesterday, yeah, like if you would have asked me before yesterday, I probably would have said, yeah, you know, we should be showing up because Brett Key hasn't showed us anything to be ashamed of. Like Jeff Collins, you know, you should, you know, I understand not wanting to show up, not wanting to support Jeff Collins. Of course, it's good to show up. At that point, you're cheering for the players, you know, because right. you want the players to all do well, and you want to pull for them and everything, even if you don't, you know, like the coach or anything and he sucks. Well, I think that, you know, when you do get a new coach, you should show up to support him. But I can't blame anybody for not wanting to watch that crap anymore. I mean, good Lord. It's like you have to have some incredibly thick skin to put up with, you know, to put up with this. And it's like, you know, not the average person is not like us that come on the internet and trash talk and have to hear it from 1,000 people. Like, you know, I consider myself to have really thick skin. Like, you have to be a YouTuber, because whenever something like this happens, it's not just me at the game watching, you know, my team suck and us losing and everything, and I'm upset. I get 100 notifications from people in my comment section telling me how shitty my Jackets are and how I'm an idiot for thinking they were good and how we're going to get blown out the rest of the way, and Georgia fans woofing at me. And
yep.
And it pushes me to my limit, you know? So I can imagine how hard it would be for the average person who's got, you know, not a lot of people are, I mean, that's just the reality. There's a lot of casual fans too. And this is a really complex issue that I've been kind of mulling over for the past few years. It's very interesting to observe, and I'll probably wind up making a video on it. You know, at this point, all I can say is I can't blame any fans that aren't showing up.
Yeah, I think it's twofold. So one, I do think someone in the comments, right, W. Kevin Long, we've never shown up super well as fans. That's certainly true. But here's the thing. That's so, to me, so far down the list of things that are contributing to our issues right now. Like, explain Duke right now. Duke holds what, 30 something thousand fans over there. Mm-hmm. Wake holds like 40 something thousand, and they're able to win football games. I imagine Wake doesn't have any better turnout than Tech does when they're down. So
right,
I just don't...
we have been down.
Yeah, and that's the other thing. There's not a fan base in this country that's going to show up and sell out their stadium every time when they have gone through what we've gone through. They're just not.
Nebraska claims to.
I don't believe. You're talking about they had the thing where like, oh, we've sold out every game since Moses wore short pants. Sellout
streak, right?
Yeah. Maybe it's a too simplistic response, but a lot of that's solved by just winning football games, you know. And Paul Johnson had success when he was here. I think I said it on Twitter. When we upset Florida State that year with the miracle on Tech Wood Drive, I think we were 1-7, something like that. We'd only won one game, and we sold that out. And it
wasn't, that was coming off of an incredible season.
It was coming off an incredible season, but the current season they were in, we had won one game. But, yeah, you're absolutely right. So you can turn that narrative. And I think it's just self-defeating to blame the fans for the fans not showing up. Mm-hmm. Well, now they're even less likely to show up because not only do they have to hear the shit that me and C-Dog do every week from people barking at us or whatever, but I got to hear it from my own fan base. So I think it's self-defeating.
Yeah, you gotta put something on – you got to build trust. You know, I feel absolutely betrayed. I feel betrayed from what I've seen yesterday. I'm horrified.
Betrayal.
I don't know if I'll ever recover. This team has lost, and Brett Key has lost so much trust that I had in them. And but it can be built back up. But it's not going to happen quickly. It's not going to happen quickly. I do think a new coach, you should show up to them and, you know, see how it goes. But it can be built back up. But, you know, it's not too much to ask. You should be able to beat Bowling Green at home in front of zero people at their stadium, packed chock full on the moon, on a neutral site. You should be able to beat them anywhere. Okay. Yeah. You shouldn't ever lose to Bowling Green. Not this team. That's not too much to ask. It's not too much to ask.
Not at all. And I mean, when I tell you my heart sank when I saw that score, it was, and you know, when Tech played Georgia last year and they were like tied at halftime or something like that, you know, Brent Key became, you know, my second pick for head coach. I wanted Dion. I figured, you know, nothing has worked the past 4 years. Let's just try something new. And not that Brent Key, you know, isn't new, but I gave him the benefit of the doubt, with Louisville especially, and then with Ole Miss, you know, I was honestly encouraged by what I saw against Ole Miss, and you know, the score wasn't nearly close to indicative of how they played for most of that game. But this is just, yeah, I think y'all are right. You know, I think back, this is the worst loss that I've ever watched. Middle Tennessee State back in like 2012 was rough. The Citadel was rough. I was just so used to pain when NIU happened. It was kind of didn't feel exactly anything after that one.
And for those people who are saying that Brent Key is still like Jeff Collins, take a minute to think about why this loss is worse than any other Jeff Collins loss. It's because we are better than this. We are above this. This team should not be putting up this performance. It's such a far cry from what it should be. That's why it's so bad. Meanwhile, Jeff Collins teams, you expect that shit from them. You expect that effort, and you expect them to get blown out and wipe the floor off. You don't expect that with these Brent Key teams. That's why it's so much worse. I'm not making excuses or anything, but that's why, as far as my expectations and reality, they were so far apart. That's why this is the worst loss I've ever seen, too. So I just thought I'd throw that in there. Not, I don't think it really helps or anything, but
no, it's true.
And just to your point, can you stop comparing Brent Key to Jeff Collins? Because I'd still rather have Brent Key, okay?
Yeah, if we're making comparisons of coaches, we could have rolled out Lou Holtz in a wheelchair to be on that sideline, and we would have looked better than we ever did under Collins. Yeah,
Collins had better performances than yesterday. I mean, it happened. I mean, it's just – it's a rough situation. It's hard to defend. I'm not going to defend it.
I just have to keep reminding myself that it's a process.
It's a process.
If it doesn't get better, then
we move on really, again.
It can't really get much worse.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
that's true.
Only up from here.
Yep. Well, man, I appreciate you calling in, homeless. Andrew, I see you in the back room. I'm tired now. I said this will be the last caller. Again, NJank22, first-time caller. Appreciate you coming in. Switch screens up here. And we'll wrap up the show here. I kind of meant to wrap up at 10. But, guys, I appreciate y'all coming out. Like, I know this is tough. It's a tough loss. But y'all are tuning in and calling, and we 100% appreciate it. I just feel like I said at the start of the show, C-Dog, I'm in like the depression phase now. Like
I am too. I'm completely besides myself. I can't believe this at all. I don't know.
Now, like I woke up this morning and I was like, I don't want to get out of bed. I really don't. I just want
to. I don't even want to think about it. Like, I don't want to talk about it. I really don't. I mean, I'll come on here and talk about it with you guys and commiserate, but like, it just ruins my day. You know, I had a good day today. Not really. I stepped on a nail today and I can barely walk. It hurts so bad.
You got your tetanus?
Yeah, I got my tetanus.
Okay. Dang, dude. Yeah.
But, dude, it hurts so bad. So, add injury to insult.
What is going on, man? Like, we need...
When it rains, it pours, man.
Yeah, it's like, did you probably, because you are averse to seeing good movies, did you ever see Jerry Maguire with...
No.
So, like, basically, he's an agent, and he takes this moral stand, and everyone leaves, and it just keeps getting worse and worse, and he says, the hits just keep on coming.
Yep, they do. And it's like, talk about the hits keep coming. Back when, you know, I've been here before, man. It's back when we get blown out 55-0 to Notre Dame, then 45-0 to Georgia, and then all of our players decommit, Jahmyr Gibbs and everybody else worth a damn lead enters the transfer portal.
Yep.
You know, all of our best coaches, like Tashard Choice, leaves. The hits kept coming and coming and coming.
Coleman left.
Yeah, Coleman left, Choice left, Gibbs left, and then, you know, a bunch of other transfers. All of our recruiting class decommitted. That was rough. This rivals that, man. This really does.
Yeah.
It really does.
And I see someone in the chat. I haven't even thought about this quite, but this is another reason why this is so devastating. Guy asked, what will Georgia Tech do if the ACC fragments? Yeah, and this is why this season was so important with conference realignment and losing to Bowling Green. Like, I don't know what happens next offseason. Every offseason there's movement with stuff, so I have no idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were supposed to come out this year and make a statement of who we are and where we're headed as a program. Well, we made a statement, all right. And I don't even want to begin to think of that stuff. I just want to let the season play out. Hopefully we can wind up being a bowl team and getting something together, and maybe we bounce back from this. I mean,
God, I hope so.
We got to find out who we are here. I think this is a crossroads. I think we'll find out quickly what we're made of, and we'll see, you know, kind of what it's going to look like here going forward.
Yeah, it's kind of like sometimes someone will ask me, like, well, what if this bad thing happened in your family or whatnot? And I'm like, I can't mentally go there. Like, I can't allow myself to go there. And that's kind of what conference realignment and this is like for me. Like, I just can't mentally go there. Like, I don't have the mental fortitude to sustain that thought right now.
It would be the worst thing, the worst feeling ever, if my Jackets were relegated to not even being in a Power 5 conference and not being able to compete at the highest level. I mean, being down for years is one thing. Like, going through the worst coach in Georgia Tech history, that's one thing. But not being able to compete at the highest level, that's a whole nother level.
Yeah, because then there's no hope anymore. Like,
right.
Your new ceiling would then be lower than your floor currently.
Exactly.
And,
yep.
F that noise, dude. I would probably, like, I might check myself in somewhere. That would be the worst.
That'd be devastating.
Look, we'll cross that bridge if we ever have to come to it. We're not there yet. We do have a game to play this Saturday, and all we can do is show up and try and change the narrative. I'll give you the last word, C Doug.
I mean, I've been through some shit on YouTube. I've been through some shit on YouTube, man. I've been here for 3 years. Nothing like this, dude. It's so bad. I can't even explain. But it's not like it's impossible to come back from this. You know, we still got a season, most of the season ahead of us. And I'm having a hard time even deploying this. WreckTalk asked me before, how did you do it? Like,
yeah,
you know, against when I, like I was talking about earlier, when we lose to Notre Dame, lose to Georgia, all, everybody decommit, everybody transfers out. I was on YouTube for all that. And, WreckTalk asked how I made it through. Cause you know, that was also, Georgia was winning the national championship that season. That was the worst season of football in my entire life. I just told myself one thing. Win, lose, or tie, I'm a Yellow Jacket till I die.
And I agree. Well, I think that's a good way to end the show. Win, lose, or tie, Yellow Jacket till I die. And we'll be here every week spouting that message. You guys have a great night. Yeah, I hope we have a better week next week. And if no one's told you, as down as I am –